Right, welcome to Connect the Dots Ministries. This is Natasha George Bomba coming into your room, coming into your space to share a little insight from the Lord with you. My dear sister, Roseanne Bomba, she tells me, Natasha, I love to hear that. And thank you, darling, for your call today and the call of encouragement. I love it. I want to say a special thanks to my dear mother as well. Thank you for the encouragement, mommy. I appreciate it. You don't know how much. I also say my husband, Mr. Mark Bomba, darling, I appreciate you. Thank you for encouraging me. Pastor Dexter Daly, thank you for encouragement as well as, and thank you for the opportunity. My sister, Nisha George, I love you. Thank you for the call today. Thank you for the encouragement as well. You are a sister indeed. Thank you to Auntie Patsy, Suzanne Bompa, Auntie Judy in Canada, as well as my Auntie Judy in Trinidad and Tobago. Thank you to Yasmin, her sister, to Rosalyn Cummins. Thank you, darlings, cousins, family members, everybody. Suzanne, I can't forget Suzanne Alexander. Thank you very much for connecting with me and giving me the encouragement. Suzanne said, Natasha, I love it when you're coming on. Thank you for the encouragement. Ayanna Chester, thank you for all your support and encouragement. Thank you very much. I really honestly appreciate it. And you know something, Connect the Dots Ministries is really, really growing like wildfire. Even today, I noticed that a lot of persons that are connected to my Facebook account, and not to mention the also the blog, they are connected, and it's very important. I just get a message from my pastor that he said, praise the Lord for this segment. So we are going, we are excited. I am definitely, I'm excited to bring forth this segment to you. It's very inspirational. It's very important that we continue to connect with each other. It is very important because why? I need you and you need me. It is very crucial at this time because, you know, the Lord himself, God himself told me that he, his son, is coming back very, very soon. Right? So, let's continue. God is God of the mountains as well as the valley. As you are well aware, I'm getting excited. Let me try to calm myself down. That God is a God of all seasons. He is a God of plenty. He is a God in lean times, a God in lack, a God in the wilderness, a God of rejoicing, as well as a God in suffering. In fact, he is a God no matter the circumstance, no matter the situation, he remains as God. Full stop. You can't take his position from him. Amen? And that's why it is comforting and reassuring to know that God's son is a carpenter. He is capable of making a way out of no way. He also performs wonders according to his will. Now, he could prepare, make a door. He could make a window. He could make a roof. He could make a way in the roof. He a custom. You just have to give him time to do so. He is a way maker. So much so, he watches over his word to perform it. If he says it's going to happen, it is going to happen. Trust me, it shall come to pass. It's just a matter of time, as I said before. Jeremiah 1:12. You have observed correctly, says the Lord, for I am watching over my word to accomplish it. You see, his word has obeyed his command. His word is active. It is alive. And once he speaks to the word, and it comes into fruition. Right. I want you to remember that, you know, his word is active and it brings forth, time is used to bring forth his word. So don't be alarmed and don't be dismayed based upon what you're seeing. Don't do it. Right? So as I said before, right? It's just a matter of time. I'm going to recap Jeremiah 1:12. You have observed correctly, says the Lord. I'm watching over my word to accomplish it. Yes, see, his word has to obey his command. It must work out accordingly to the latter. And that's why we may have to go through some valley-like experiences before his word comes into fruition. So let his word work. Wait very patiently on the Lord. Why, you may ask? Because he is working on your word to perform it. That's why. Right. As humans, we often miss the opportunity of realizing the magnitude of the God we serve. And unfortunately, we tend to focus on the problems we encounter on a day-to-day basis, forgetting that God's intentions are pure towards us. He doesn't want to harm us in any way, but indeed, he seeks ways to reassure us of his undying love. So much so, he had offered his only begotten son as a ransom to all. Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. To give you a future and a hope. Right? So God is not a wicked God. God is a good God. God is a good God. He wants us to be good. Just like his nature. He does not want us. He doesn't want us to operate out of his nature. He wants us to be good. Just like him. In fact, he doesn't offer all sunny days. But in John 16:33, I have told you these things so that in me you will have peace. In this you may have peace. Let's read that again. There is something very important that he said. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. Sometimes we could be in him, but we don't have peace. Why? Because we're dwelling on the situation. In this world, you will have trouble. But take heart, I have overcome the world. This means Jesus is capable of handling your tomorrows. A man for all seasons. That is who he is. Jesus is a man for all seasons. At this time, I would like to use the opportunity to draw a parallel between Sir Thomas More, Elijah, Moses, and Jesus. If you agree with me, they can all be considered as men of all seasons. That's what I learned in school, that story. A man for all seasons. If you have the time and space, you could go ahead and look at it, right? So, they could all be considered, Sir Thomas More, Elijah, Moses, Jesus, could all be considered as a man for all seasons. Since they were all persecuted for their beliefs and the principles in one way or another, but they still managed to maintain their principles and belief system even at the very end. Jesus, for example, he was killed because he had claimed to have much authority for himself. He had claimed too much authority for himself, Moses, he wanted the Israelites to worship and trust God. So much so, his zeal made him disobey God's instruction. Instead of he's supposed to speak to the rock, he ended up hitting the rock. He didn't follow instructions. Yeah. Prophet Elijah, he wanted the Israelites to worship the true and living God, and his zeal had endangered his life and his well-being. No, God didn't tell him to go and kill the 450 prophets, false prophets. He didn't. God didn't tell him that. What God told him is just to present yourself to the king Ahab. But he was zealous. He decided to deal with them. But then when once he dealt with them, Jezebel, you know, threatened him and say, hey, the same time tomorrow, you are dead. You are dead, man. Just like them, you're dead. So he took it upon himself and ran. He flee for his life. Right. Sir Thomas More, a Chancellor of England, he was executed for not endorsing King Henry VIII's plight to divorce his wife, Catherine of Aragon. So he didn't want to endorse the king, to encourage the king to divorce his wife and choose another one, because according to him, which is true, it is a wrong, it's wrong to do. And according to God's sight, it is wrong to do. But God offered certain exemption, you know, so you can read the word of God and you will understand. So let's face facts. If you want to be used by God in a mighty way, first he must allow you and I to go through a wilderness experience, because unfortunately it is a prerequisite to truly gain real access to God's supernatural power. You can refer to my book on page 59. Pain is a prerequisite to access power. And in my book, which is called I'm the author, first time author of Push Through Your Pain, your pain has power. This was clearly identified in Matthew chapter 17, verse 1. After six days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, the brother of James, and led them up in the high mountain by themselves. There he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun. His clothes became as white as the light. Just then, they appeared before them, Moses and Elijah, talking to Jesus. Now, Jesus, God allowed them to see Jesus in his glorified state on the mountain, but after which God will take him in a valley experience, you know, again. And this experience was in his life, but he was glorified. Peter and everybody was allowed to see Jesus glorified before it happened. So now Jesus is glorified because he went through his wilderness experience. Right. So that is wonderful. That is amazing. And after seeing this, Peter wanted to worship all three of them. But God only acknowledged Jesus only by saying to his disciples, this is my son whom I love. With him I'm well pleased. Listen to him. And that is what God told me. He said, my son will be coming back soon. Right? He told me that. So look out for him. Demand now. Elijah was under spiritual attack. Sometimes when you go through, most of the times when you go through your wilderness experience, you'll be going through a spiritual attack. But before he had to be exalted, God had to allow the breaking process. And this process was proven to be very devastating for Elijah. So much so, when he was threatened by Jezebel, he flee for his life immediately because he was too absorbed in his own emotions, because he lacked courage. He only focused on the situation and not on how God had helped him in the past, how God provided for him. He was only thinking about the present problem. So he asked God to die because he had enough. According to him, remember, everybody have a limit. That was his limit. You have to respect the prophet for his limit. You understand? But I just want to encourage you, and I want to encourage myself, that when you see this happening, you really have to muster all the faith that is possible to continue. Because why? Elijah and Moses coming back again, you know, because they didn't complete a particular task for the Lord, so they're going to come back again, right? Because they are the two witnesses. They're going to come back again, and they're going to witness Elijah. It was known for calling down fire, right? He was a prophet like that, so he's going to call down fire again the next time he comes to supply. God first sent an angel to sustain him. Then he visited him and counseled him. And when God realized he really had enough, he made mention to him about Elisha, his successor. And eventually he took him up into heaven by a chariot of fire. Now remember, as I said before, Elijah mastered the mystery of mastery of fire. He had faith to call on fire. And God used the same thing to carry him up in a chariot of fire. Awesome. Because why? You have to be able to master something in life. And that is what Elijah decided to master. Falling on fire. That's an impossible task. He had enough faith to do that. So do you have enough faith to do the impossible? Do you have enough faith? It takes faith to call on fire. It takes faith to stop rain. What is your faith? Are you maximizing fear? Are you maximizing anxiousness, anxiety? No. It starts by faith, maximizing your faith. And that is why I'm telling you to maximize the life, maximize it, set it in motion. And that is what I am trying to ignite it. Ignite it. Honestly, could you imagine Elijah if he had only completed his mission? If he had only had the willpower to continue? As I said before, everybody have their limit, right? But as children of the Most High God, not only that, we have information about Elijah and his experience so we can build on it, right? We must continue to strive despite our obstacles or challenges, because they are no match for our God, because he is indeed God of all situations. God could have allowed him to continue, no, but he realized that he really had enough. You know, he was looking after that victory. He was looking for encouragement. He was looking for support, but he did not get it. He got threatened, right? There are always lessons to be learned in the valley life experiences. Don't lose sight of your calling. What you have mastered can bring you out of your valley. You are somebody's hero. God is with you. We are not alone. Remember, someone is going through a similar or even worse experience just like you. Focus on past victories and not your current state, because it will be magnified by 10 times over. Encourage yourself in the Lord and read his word. Be there and be a support to somebody else. Speak to a trustworthy person. Place your trust and confidence in him, because he is in the valley. He is in the valley with you. Valley-like experiences often lead to self-awakening, self-discovery. Many hidden truths will be revealed. How did you get there in the first place? That is what God asked Elijah. What are you doing here? Was it of your own choice, or did God place you there? So if God placed you there, he will sustain you there. If you place yourself there, well, then you have to ask God for grace and mercy to take you out. Right. You will discover your weaknesses, the vulnerabilities of what lies beneath. It will give you an opportunity to put a name on it, so that you can make a corrective change. During this season, you'll discover who are your destiny helpers, you know, your enemies. God will shield you. Refuse to allow them to draw energy from you. Allow God to work you through the process, because he is a way maker. You are never alone. And the last one I like. Life has a funny way of pushing you up the mountain again, if only you remain patient. If you remain patient, God will work it out for you. So this is Natasha George Bombard coming to you, into your home, coming to in your space, to share this insight from the Lord with you. It is very important that you continue in this journey of life. Do not give up so easily. Do not quit. I'm hearing things that people giving up easily. Do not give up easily, because why? We are in this together, right? That is why I'm coming into your home, coming into your space, to encourage you and to give you the energy, to give you the fuel to maximize your faith. You need to continue. You cannot quit. You cannot stop. Because why? We are depending on you to continue. We need you here. I need you in my world, right? To work. I need you in your world to continue working. Now, we are connected. Your world is connected to mine. If something happens to you, what happens to me, you will feel, you will be affected in some way or some fashion. So we need to be there for each other. We need to connect. So this is Connect the Dots Ministry, and it is going like wildfire. So thank you for connecting the dots with me. Stay blessed and stay strong. Remember, what you have maximized, your potential will allow you to come out of your valley. You have to master it, and it will help you to come out of your valley. Stay strong. Be blessed. Bye.